This talk I have chosen particularly for a reason, because I feel that the Nehruvian system somehow or the other has not disappeared from the country. And it is a major problem because it is still drawing the country back, maybe into the 19th century India, maybe into pre-independence India. And the majority of people, including perhaps the ruling Bharatiya Janata Party, doesn't realize the very great unfortunate consequences of the lingering socialism and the lingering secularism along with it. Because secularism is part of the Fabian socialism which Nehru believed in. Now, I'm going to mention just a few things, because you see, this is a very wide topic and too much has been written on it. And there is a whole lobby in the Western world which tries to tell us Indians what is the idea of India. And the idea of India, of course, was spelt by Nehru himself, which could be just put in one line. Karwaan aate rahe, Hindostan banta gaya. That is, there is nothing original about India. India has been settled by people from outside, some invaders, some maybe not invaders like the Parsis, but in any case, it is the outsiders who constitute the reality of what is Indian civilization. Now, this was the idea which he had somehow acquired, maybe not in his Fabianism, but in the history that he was taught, partly at Cambridge and partly during the time when he became himself the first Prime Minister of India. So it is in the location of this history that he placed his Fabian socialism. Now, I'm not going to talk so much about the culture, the economic aspect of it. I'm going to take up the cultural aspect. But of course, culture or Sanskriti, or in our old terms, Artha, Dharma, Kam, and Moksha, they all go together. So if culture is affected in one way, then dharma, artha, and kam, and moksha will all be affected together. Now, leaving the old language and coming down to the modern language, that if you make some very severe cultural choices, your country will not progress, and you would have what the Marxists very cynically called the Hindu rate of growth. Actually, the Marxist rate of growth was converted into the Hindu rate of growth because they wanted to run down Hinduism. But then, where does this all begin? Among the many things that Nehru instilled in our mind, and this is the crux of it. The crux of it is he instilled into our minds that there is a contradiction between tradition and modernity. In India, we have always believed that tradition modernizes itself, that tradition makes itself relevant to the times, that what is called in our system as smriti. And smriti is not just memory of the law codes, or the achar, but the smriti of almost everything that we have inherited civilizationally. Now, that smriti, including the law codes, including the culture, including the various vidyas, the sciences, including the way of seeking knowledge, which we had practiced for thousands of years, was just by one sweep of hand set aside by Nehru's Fabianism. He paid lip service to it, but in practice, he created a chasm between modernity and tradition. Modernity in Nehru's time was initiated to mean a rejection of tradition. You see, this was the most important thing. And what is the root of this idea that Nehru had? The root is the white man's burden. Now, you're all familiar with the white man's burden, that since 18th century, the European classes always thought that they were delivering the natives from religious ignorance into the world of light of Christianity and civilization, into something forward, beautiful, that they, in the words of their poet Tennyson, were going beyond the sunset. They were continuously sailing and exploring new territory, something new they were adding on. So they had this evolutionary idea also. So this enlightenment burden, which elevated the white man as the deliverer of mankind, was at the root of Nehru's bias against Indian tradition. You see, when some white people, some scholars, for instance, the French scholar Alain Danialou, he met Nehru. Nehru told him, "We are trying to get rid of everything that you have come to study here." Now, you know that Danialou was a great investigator, that he went deep into Indian systems, that he became a disciple of one of the greatest scholars of India, Swami Karpatri, and he contributed so much to Indian musicology, culture, philosophy. Now, this man was told by Nehru that Nehru wanted to get, or he used the word we means modern India, we are trying to get rid of what Alain Danielou had come in search for. So nothing can be more blatant than this. And this is something which Danielou has mentioned, and it can be checked in print. Now, another fact that we have to see here is this, that we are all convinced that Nehru was a close cooperator, an intellectual inheritor, or almost a ward of Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi ji, Mahatma Gandhi as he is called. But in reality, Jawaharlal Nehru practiced an economics and a cultural policy which was in direct contradiction to Gandhi's ideas. You see, Gandhi wanted growth in India, and growth not just economic, but every kind of growth, to be village-centric. He wanted the village to be the place where growth would be directed to. And also, as his famous quote is, that whenever I do something or whenever you do something, think of the poorest man of India. So the poorest man of India belongs to the village, even today as then. And so one had to think of the village first and the city later. Nehru brought in the Soviet model, in which it is the capital which will do all kinds of planning. Not only the five-year plans which he imported, the idea which he imported from Soviet Union, but any planning would be done entirely at the center of New Delhi, at the secretariat which was inherited by Nehru's government from the British. So you see, in terms of ambience, in terms of place, in terms of function, it was entirely a continuation of the colonial Raj. So Nehru Raj was just nominally different from the British Raj. As far as his own cooperators were concerned, his fellow travelers in politics were concerned, people like Kanhaiyalal Munshi, K.M. Munshi, who founded the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, who was a great literateur, a poet, people like him, people like Rajgopalachari, people like Purushottam Das Tandon, who was a great savant for modern Hindi literature and who promoted Hindi. People like him either left Nehru or they just went very quiet. Like Purushottam Das Tandon did not leave the Congress. K.M. Munshi did. Rajgopalachari did. What was the reason of all these people leaving Nehru's company? It was primarily this contradiction that for Nehru, tradition was something to which you can only pay lip service. And of course, Nehru was a man adept in his English, and he could speak very nice and flowery language. In fact, that was the only language he could speak and read and write. He could not read or write any Indian language at all. And I say this from my own personal experience. He was indeed a great orator. In 1957, when 100 years were celebrated of the First War of Independence, Nehru spoke in Ramlila grounds in Delhi for 1 hour. And I was there as a child of 11, listening to that speech. So I can see from my own experience that Nehru's rendition of Hindi was extremely ordinary, in fact, plebeian. So the point that I am trying to make is that his grip on any Indian language was extremely cursory. He was rooted in English, and he used that in a very flowery style to pay all kinds of compliments to tradition, but nothing of tradition was translated practically. For instance, if you go to Chennai and you go to the Music Academy Madras, you will find that they have displayed a quote by Jawaharlal Nehru. When Nehru met M.S. Subbulakshmi, he said, "What am I before a queen of music, a mere prime minister?" So, you know, he said, he is just a mere prime minister, and M.S. Subbulakshmi was the queen of music. Now, this is all very nice, and Music Academy has displayed it, just as so many quotes from Nehru praising Indian culture, Sanskrit language, this and that, are repeatedly made part of books or propaganda material by the Congress Party. But the fact is that Nehru's concept of modernity was very, very contradictory. As a matter of fact, inimical to all the essential values of tradition. Let's take the question of language. There were many people who had suggested very seriously at that time, and B.R. Ambedkar was one of them. that Sanskrit should be made the official language of India. Call it official language, lingua franca for official purposes, language of education, language of courts, etc., whatever. The official language should be Sanskrit, and Sanskrit should be restored to the status which it had before the arrival of the Turks, which it had lost for almost 800 years. Now, this was something to be seriously debated, examined, and thought of. But the whole idea was very, very cursorily put aside. People thought that it was fantastic, that it was what may be called in modern political jargon as communal. But the fact is that it was not. It was a real idea. And today, if we look at Israel, which came into its own pretty much the same time as India, they have developed the Hebrew language to an extent that nobody can say that it falls short of any function of the modern state. So Sanskrit could have fulfilled that whole thing much better, because we have a huge tradition of intellectual product and exertion in the Sanskrit language. As a matter of fact, let alone Sanskrit, it is Jawaharlal primarily who did not even want Hindi to take its place, or Sanskritized Hindi, or even Hindustani, as it was called by Mahatma Gandhi, to take its place as the official language. And he brought in this whole, this whole questionable idea of English as the window to the outer world. Now, this is, again, a typical example of flamboyance, Nehru's flamboyance. Now, when you use a language within the country, you are not so much worried about its use as window to the outer world. Window to the outer world is for diplomats, for intellectuals who want to go and study abroad, for scientists who want to pursue research abroad. But within the country, a language which is primarily a foreign language and a language of your erstwhile rulers and oppressors, how can that language be something that serves your national interest? So we were given this very fine, lollipop, window to the outer world. And as a matter of fact, the window became larger and larger till it became a hole in the roof. And therefore, we find today that not only Hindi, not only Sanskrit, but none of the Indian languages have flourished since independence. The best literature in the 20th century in any Indian language is before 1947. In modern times, I mean. And today, the languages of India are entirely cut out from each other. I mean, they are not in contact with each other. So this establishment of English was primarily for continuation of the Anglophonic class. It was not the window to the outer world. I think I need not go on laboring this point, because everybody understands that the ruling class today and the ruling elite of India consists mainly, other than of course its legislators, who are not Anglophones and who are not Anglo-centric, but the ruling class consists of the university professors and the university teachers, the bureaucracy, IAS, IFS, and all the gazetted officers, and the judiciary. And all these three classes, namely the professors, the bureaucrats, and the judiciary, they only use the English language only as a habit, as a continuation of what the British had already established, not because they have looked out of this window and studied something very new, relevant, and fresh from the Western world. If they look to the Western world, they only look to copy it. If we want to study our own literature, well, then we like to study it in the translations of Wendy Doniger and Michael Witzel and various other Indologists in Germany, Europe, and United States. So it is not a window through which we see outside, but it is a window or a hole in the roof in which everything is shoved into our home from outside. So this has been the consequence of Anglophilia of Jawaharlal Nehru. And it can be seen today as practiced by the ruling elite, the Anglophonic elite of India. And that is why India is divided into two classes. The Anglophones, who wield power and who are with the establishment, and all those who are not Anglophones. Very often people ask me today that what is the political situation of the country? How is the country divided? And I say that, look, the country is not divided between Congress and Narendra Modi. The country is divided between the Anglophones and those who speak the Indian languages. This is the real division. And this is the real politics. And this is the legacy of Nehru. I go on to another big cultural damage that Nehru started, and which in many ways is still continuing. In some respects, the reformists of BJP are still not free of it. You know, he perpetuated a falsehood. Sometimes it is called a myth, but I have great respect for the word myth, because in Greek, myth meant what Puran means in Sanskrit. So Nehru started this falsehood called the scientific temperament. Now, you see, this is a typical example of how the Enlightenment culture was made into something very plebeian and enforced upon the Indian people. Here, we were taught that the scientific temperament is what comes to India from Europe. It comes to India in the 19th century. It comes to India as a rational way of thinking which did not exist earlier. Now, I don't have to labor the point, especially not in Sangam talks, where you have hundreds of talks by now on the Indian knowledge system, that the Indian systems, whether of philosophy or of art or of literature and poetry, or of technology of the times, ancient times, were entirely logical, that they were based on a discursive method, that the whole epistemology which we value in philosophy is an epistemology of investigation, personal investigation, individual investigation, collective investigation. So this whole myth, as if the scientific temperament is a rationality, was, it was like a club. It was like a stick which was used to batter the Indian Vidyas, which were called unscientific. You know, when the BJP government came into power in 1999, the Marxists started this big debate that Jyotish is unscientific. Now, everybody in India knows that Jyotish is not just Phalit, or it is not astrology. It is also astronomy. And the both are closely connected. And we had this big debate at JNU where they wanted to introduce Jyotish, and there was a massive retaliation from the Marxists. You would be surprised to know that I was approached by a famous Indologist and an astrologer, astronomist of the West, Professor Pingree. And Pingree said that, look, if your universities cannot use the money which your government is trying to invest in the universities, please send those grants to me and I will do it here in my university. I think he was in Yale at that time or some other university. I forget, it's a long time back. So, as always, the people in the West know what is the value of Indian logic, Indian vidyas, and to say the least, they are not non-scientific. So this whole idea of Indian systems of knowledge, Indian vidyas as non-scientific did immense harm. You know the state of Ayurveda today in India after 70 years. Ayurveda would have done wonders. It did wonders. It still did wonders. From my personal experience, I was saved from death by Ayurvedic medicine not once but twice in my life. So I can talk from personal experience that it works. But even to this day, we have plenty of people who go on calling Ayurveda as superstition, as unscientific, as something which is lacking in the scientific temperament. The corollary to the scientific temperament business was a kind of nihilism which was imported into India. Now, Fabian socialism is resting on the foundations of Marxism. And Marxism is very clear that religion is the opium of the masses. And if it is the opium of the masses, then all kinds of religious studies in India would be something not scientific, not modern, not permissible. And as a result of this, something very serious happened. I will talk about that a little later, but let me just mention that this bias against all Indian knowledge systems was made part of the Constitution as early as 1950. How? You see, the Indian Constitution in its Article 28, Section 1 makes it very clear that no institution fully or partially funded by the government will give any religious instruction. Now, this word religious instruction is so ambiguous. But what happened in practice was very simple. Anything which was old, which was part of the Indian knowledge system, whether it is poetry, literature, Rig Veda, or any Shastra, Natyashastra, Kama Shastra, or the Shastras which talk about various kinds of alloys to be made. All this was considered as religious instruction, and they were not permitted to enter the curriculum of the universities. So, as a result, you do not have any Department of Indian Studies or Indian Tech Studies in Indian universities. It's only that some text of Advaita and things like that are studied in the Sanskrit department, which are totally isolated, to the point of being ostracized, even to this day in Indian universities. And the whole tradition of knowledge of India under Article 28, Section 1 could not be legally made part of the education system. Now, everybody knows the education ministers we had and what followed finally in 1970 under Soviet pressure and when the system was handed over to Marxists entirely. But it is Nehru who laid the foundations. It is Nehru who made the constitution. And in that very constitution, in that very article, there is a justification to block the study of Indian knowledge systems. And that is why to this day, all these studies are outside the universities. Now I come to another point, something which we must understand in the broader perspective. You see, the socialist state is a welfare state, supposedly. Whether it is actually or not, that's a matter of debate. But in theory, the welfare state sounds very attractive. And Marxism, when it came into India, had a lot of takers. Some people even in good faith thought that it was not a contradiction of Ramarajya, that Ramarajya and Marxism could go hand in hand, that Marxism means taking care of the poorest, proletariat means taking care of the poorer, and it was peddled that way. But the very idea that the state shall own everything, that the state shall then, after owning everything, will provide for everything, worked entirely against the socio-economic system which India had practiced since time immemorial. How? I come here to point out that the Indian Varna Ashram system, the Indian system which was based upon Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra, this system was an economic system primarily. And in these systems, people were trained to pursue certain skills as per their inheritance and as per the education which was imparted to them. So, people who were pursuing knowledge, formal knowledge, studies, shastras, were the Brahminical class. Now, that class ceases to have any identity when the modern socialist state says that we are going to give you education. Till the 18th century, people would send their children, at least those who could afford or those who were permitted, to the Gurukulas, and it was the Brahmanas who were teaching. Now, since 19th century, when we had this whole prejudice against the Brahmins, and when they were defined as the evildoers of Hinduism, then the education went into the hands of the socialist state. And lo and behold, what does the socialist state do? The socialist state makes it very clear in Article 28, Section 1, that nothing which you inherit for which you inherit for since from your civilization will be part of your education. So then, this whole class, which was adept at learning, goes on to learn what? They go on to that kind of learning which will provide them jobs in the government which would promote bureaucracy. So this was Macaulay's legacy, which Nehru promoted. So the intellectual class of India was wiped out by socialism. There was no freedom. It was university which decided. And how could anybody even have a debate in a university when the texts were not studied, when people had no knowledge of the text? I joined Delhi University in 1972. This is long after I, as a teacher. Of course, I joined Delhi University as a student in 1964, the very year Nehru passed away. But then I started teaching in 72. And what do I find there? I wanted to study something which belonged to my tradition and something which belonged to the so-called Western tradition. I found no teachers. I had knowledge of Sanskrit. I could study it from traditional pundits or from somebody in the Sanskrit department. But there were no studies of what is called Indology today at the university. There was no department of Hindu studies. And within 1978 or 1979, I once went up to the vice chancellor of the university and I said, "Sir, you have a department of Buddhist studies, but you don't have a department of Hindu studies. Why not?" He said, "Young man, we can't provide you anything because the constitution doesn't allow that. Buddhist studies department can exist because it is a minority religion. Islamic studies can be done because it is a minor." Of course, about Islamic studies and Islam or so-called minority religions, you have Article 30, which provides them everything right from primary level to the highest level. So that's another story. So what happens here is that the intellectual traditions of India find no place. Now you come up to, I am metaphorically speaking, the Kshatriyas. Don't look upon it only in terms of so-called caste or jati, but look upon it as a class. The people who guard your borders, the people who provide you security, they are your security forces. They are your fighting forces. They are the army, navy, and air force. Nehru initiated a system. I am not going to talk about how Nehru once upon a time thought that there was no need for an army, etc. I'm not going into all that. You have plenty of material on the internet and lectures about it. But I'm going to point out just one thing. Nehru instituted a bureaucracy in which the army cannot purchase even a screwdriver unless the secretary of the government of India makes an approval. So where is the independence of the Kshatriyas? Now I'm talking here metaphorically. And we know how dissatisfied the Indian armed forces have been, because they are still serving in some way or the other under the pressure of the IAS. So this kind of burden which they have to bear is something against the interest of those who defend the nation. Now come to the third, the Vaishya class. You know, in 60s and 70s, if you wanted to say to somebody that he is an absolute miser, that he is not going to even provide you a cup of tea, Did you know what you told him? Yaar, tu to saleb, Tata Birla hai. Tu to Dalmia hai. So the entrepreneur class, the industrialist, the businessman was a term of abuse. I mean, this is something which was a common joke in my college days, that we'll stand in St. Stephen's College, drink our water from, the water cooler called Katie, and make all kinds of very witty remarks. And we think that witty remarks will get us into the IAS. And they usually did. And we still have a large number of people who make their political careers out of witty remarks. Now, and then when we went for coffee, and if a friend said, I'm not going to treat you for the coffee, then we said, Ye to sala Tata Birla hai. Now, I'm putting these things very bluntly and maybe to the very roughly to the taste of some people. But that is the truth. You know, this is the time when K. N. Raj, who was the Vice Chancellor of Delhi University in my period as a student there, K. N. Raj invented this term, Hindu rate of growth. In a Marxist state, when Indira Gandhi was, when for some time Lal Bahadur Shastri and later on Indira Gandhi was ruling, and everything was according to the Marxist system, the Marxist welfare state, and the economy was entirely state-owned. There was no liberalization long before Manmohan Singh and P.V. Narasimha Rao. The rate of growth was called Hindu rate. So the Hindu text, the Hindu thought, which was not part of the intellectual system of the university or any other institution, was blamed for the economic growth rate of the country. You can see these very examples, which I'm taking from common experience, my own experience, and people of my age would vouch for that, that I am not creating a fiction, but I'm talking from something which can be corroborated by thousands of others. So this is what the country was brought to. The country did not believe in enterprise. People stopped believing in enterprise. Whereas enterprise was the very crux of the economy of India. Since ancient times, the business people of this country were going across the seas. They were going across the country, across the nation, establishing their businesses, not just the Marwaris, but dozens of them, and who held who wielded power in economic terms based on enterprise, community enterprise, in which their jati was almost a capital and a capital holder. Now, all this was set aside by the welfare state, by the Fabian socialist state, and all this burden was taken by the government. And let me ask you, what did the government consist of? Or let me ask you very boldly, what does the government consist of today? I am sorry to say that maybe 90% of our legislators don't even meet the basic educational qualifications. The Indian Constitution today does not want that in order to become a member of a parliament, you should even have a high school certificate. There are no eligibility conditions. And if an eligibility condition in terms of a BA or a high school is sought to be implemented, then people like Amartya Sen say that this is a limitation on personal freedom. So the contradiction in which we are living and the various kinds of denials that we have been pushed into by this Fabian socialism is not something to be forgotten, because we still have to remedy it. Now I come to the working class, which were called Shudras once. Now that's a pejorative word. As everybody should understand, the Shudra did not mean just a Chandal. Today, when you read about the ancient Indian caste system or the caste system, then the word Shudra is equated with people who lived outside the village or outside the city, who were untouchables, etc. But no. Shudra meant people who were working with their hands. That is the artisans, the people who produced. They were the backbone of Indian economic system. They were all the karmakaras. And it is these people in whom the great skills, whether of making saris and fabrics or of swords or whatever, it is in these people that these skills resided. What happens to these people? The socialist state says that it is going to provide jobs, but it is not going to provide any training to these people to continue their family professions or their skills, or let alone their family professions, any profession or skill, any skill which they may want to do it. Okay. You don't want that a barber's son should be a barber. So in the age of freedom, he should be whatever he likes to be. But at least you should be able to provide him how to be a good barber. And not just how to be a barber sitting at the end of a street under a tree, but to be a barber who can open his own shop or saloon, or who can even make things which can be exported. So that whole idea that our working class, which was always, even in Mughal times, was a skilled class, a highly skilled class, should be promoted at the village level, at the lowest level, was not the idea of the socialist state. You see, why did these mistakes happen? They happened because the British handed over the power to the last Englishman, as he called himself. Now, this is something which we are still not able to come out of. And I'm going to now mention that for the working class, what was thought to be the army of deliverers, who would save them from exploitation, was the trade unions. So under the socialist state, if you gave trade unions to the workers, if you gave organizations at that level to organize them in terms of politics and in terms of voting class, then you thought that you did a lot for them, that you delivered them from denial of their rights. But to provide them skills, to make them independent, to let them have an opportunity to climb up in the social ladder independently, which was the method in which India was working for thousands of years, that was totally set aside. And even to this day, we are living in that same bind, in that same problem. So, you see, the last thing which was part of this Fabian socialism, as inherited from the British, was something like this. Nehru divided the whole society into majority and minority. He was following the colonial model that the governed societies, the societies governed by the colonial powers, consist of diverse kinds of ethnicities. Religious ethnicities, linguistic ethnicities, people who could be divided according to classifications of color, clothing, anthropological features, this and that. And identity was to be given to them on that basis. So, on one hand, you castigate them for following a Varnashram Vyavastha. So, if somebody says, I am a Baniya, then you say, oh, you still believe in caste system. We must eliminate this caste system. But on the other hand, you divide them into new classifications, which are classifications made by the modern state along colonial lines. And for this, the biggest ploy that not only the British, but the French or the Germans also, or the Belgians always used, and you can see in numerous examples in Latin America and Africa and Asia, was to create a fundamental division between minority and majority. In India, somehow, practically speaking, effectively, minority and majority just got divided into Hindu and Muslim. That was the basis of partition of the country. And then this whole thing continued. Now, what happens with this kind of a division is simply this, that you create an inequality which is disguised as humanity. You make some people a minority. You say that you are going to help them. You say that you are going to give them special rights, and that minority then, by claiming all those rights, as in India, gets emboldened to such an extent that it wants the majority to continue to have lesser rights than them. You see, this is the paradigm, that the minority would feel victimized, that it would constantly ask for more and more. It would blame the majority for oppressing it and eventually make the majority less equal than itself. And this is exactly what happened when we go from Article 28 to 29 and 30. In 29, you say simply that any linguistic group or any group based on use of script. Now, that only meant Urdu, you see. It did not mean the script of Telugu or the script of Assami. It only meant Urdu. So, any community which identifies itself with the language of the script has a right to preserve that. Okay, that could apply to almost everybody in India. But then it gets translated into something very specific when we come to Article 30, which says that any group on the basis of religion, which is a minority, can open its own institutions and give the way the education they like. So as a result, we have a complete Hindu-Muslim divide in India, the foundations of which were constitutionalized by Jawaharlal Nehru. I don't want to go into the history of the debates that did take place and how many people opposed the formation of particularly Article 30. But the fact is that Article 30 today ensures that a particular version of Islam, which sometimes is called radical Islam, is taught in hundreds and thousands of madrasas in India. So what you have here is an inequality. Under Article 28, you cannot teach anything which you have inherited from the past, which is non-Muslim, that is, which is Hindu, broadly speaking. Under Article 30, you can teach anything which is related to the Muslim era. So historically, you reconfirm the rights of superiority which the Muslim ruling class had taken during the occupation of India from 12th century onwards. Now, this is exactly a doing of Nehru, because he was the leader of the house. He was the leader who ruled India from 1947 to 1964. And there is nobody else who is responsible for this constitution, because others in his party were no more than yes men. And he himself was installed against the wishes of his party people by the obstinacy of Mahatma Gandhi. So I have given you now this analysis. And the final thing that I would say is that Nehru's whole socialism actually rested on three words. These words I have chosen not from English language, but from Urdu Hindi. These three words are Ashrafiya, Afsari, and Akhliyat. Ashrafiyat means elitism. In the Muslims, there is a class of Ashrafs or Ashraf, those who thought that they came from Iran, Turan, here and there, they were the royal blood people, and therefore they were better than the Arzals or the Ajlafs of the Muslim society here. You know, this is the Muslim caste system which operated in India and still does. So, but the Ashraf were the Anglophones. As I said right at the beginning, it's the hegemony of the English language. If you want to see details, you can see an article of mine on the net called Anglophonic Hegemonies and Indian Languages. If you search for it, you'll find it, where I've given a whole detail of this. But in practice, the English language is the language of the ruling class of India. It's not the political party that rules. It is this Anglophonic class that rules. To implement the dictates of this class, you have a bureaucracy, or what I called here, Afsari. So, Ashrafiya, Afsari, and then Akhliya, which is the minority. Creation of minority. From the wholeness of India, you go on creating minorities. So, in the 19th century, the British taught the Sikhs that they were not Hindus. So, some of the Hindus became Sikhs as non-Hindus. And therefore, they also wanted to claim a Punjabi Subah in 1947. Then, of course, we have the Akhliyat of Muslims. And then we created the Akhliyats of Jain and the Lingayats. And I don't know how many more minorities you would create. So this kind of socialism was a very poisonous mixture of colonialism, of Anglophonic hegemony, of looking to the West and looking to it constantly to seek solutions and not looking within. So these are the things which I analyze as the cultural damages of Nehruvian socialism. If I can very briefly say, where do we go from now? How do we set these things right? I have mentioned Nehru and I have talked about him only to analyze him. Not that I am preoccupied with him. I am preoccupied with the future. Now, if you have to create, if we have to create a new climate in our country, we have to reverse a constitutional thrust that we have today. What is the constitutional thrust today? Under Rousseau's philosophy of promoting equality, liberty, and fraternity, we say rights is the first thing. So everybody has to be ensured, it is to be ensured that everybody is able to have their rights. And we go on manufacturing different classes who have rights. So right from children's right to women's right to people of all kinds, we have to give them rights. Now, I would say that this is exactly the opposite of how India has lived for. India believed that before rights, you have duties. Duties before rights. Now, duties before right does not mean that you deny rights, but that you ensure that anybody who is asking for any kind of a right, or as a matter of fact for anything, is performing certain duties. And those duties are non-negotiable. And freedom has to be associated with those duties. I'll take a very simple example. You have a farmers' protest and they're sitting and blocking the highways. And neither the Honorable Supreme Court of India nor the Honorable Prime Minister of India has been able to remove them. They are creating a criminal obstruction. They have killed hundreds of people who would have reached hospitals and they could not reach the hospitals by blocking their road. And we still worship their right to protest. Now, this is a clear example of a perversion. So your duty, your first duty, is to keep the road open, to let everybody go, not to take away anything because I want it. You see, this whole business that if I want something, then there is somebody else who is just going to give it either from his personal property or even from his right to live. So this whole business of asking before giving. Now, I can go on multiplying example. We believe that free education has to be given from nursery class to PhD. But you never ask, what will you do till you have done your PhD? Will you do any service to the nation? Or will you just pay taxes once you get employment, and that employment also you want the government to ensure? See, this whole perversion of freedom or rights, in which there is no place for duty, in which nobody wants to ask for what is duty. Now, that is, I think, a very serious thing. Whenever a right is to be defined, it has to go at the same time with a duty. Now let me continue with the example of education. In a modern capitalist society such as United States of America, you take a loan from bank. And then you pay your tuition fee. And it is your duty then to pay back that loan. So paying back your loan becomes your duty. And then the fact that you will be able to serve while you are taking education, which was the case world over before this funny kind of liberalism took over in the whole world, that you were paying by service. That if you went to a gurukul, then you would look after the cows, that you will repair the house in which you live, that you did all kinds of service to maintain that institution. And when you came back, then lifelong you were giving something to your gurukul, because that is from where you had taken your education. So it was a society based on trust, that it gave you admission free, that it taught you free, but then extracted some service from you there and then, the minimum at least. And most people, I would say nearly all people, when they started earning in Grihastha Ashram, they would be giving something or the other throughout their lives to the alma mater. Now, this was a system which was followed in India. That is why India had such a marvelous education system, such a great diversity of art. So, duty of giving. Now, the duty of giving was something performed by everybody, the lowest. Because daan was considered to be the highest duty. And it was considered to be the highest duty of all sections of society. Even those sections of society which did not pay any taxes. There were many sections of Indian society who were not obliged to pay taxes under law. But daan was something they were expected to do. And they did, unless they were paupers or very poor. I am trying to point out at the fact that the give and take cycle in society was entirely disrupted by the modern welfare state, which in modern times is either a capitalist state or a socialist state. It is a welfare state, it's a socialist state where you pay nothing, but the state is supposed to look after your care, your education, your life, your everything. And similarly, the capitalist state is supposed to do. But we all know that it has not worked. It does not work. It cannot work. And very prosperous societies today, like United States of America, are finding it impossible to fund college education, higher education, arts, and even the what is called social welfare or social security and medicine. So it is a system which has failed in modern times, whether in a capitalist society or in a socialist society. And we can always revive, I would not say go back, but revive the classical Indian system in which giving, and in giving in various ways, or performing duties comes before you ask for rights. Secondly, the state will own the minimum property and institutions. You see, modern welfare state says that it can do everything. Therefore, it thinks that it is a right to own everything. And in India, one of the greatest tragedy is that the state now owns even temples. It owns temples against the constitution of India. But in practice, it is considered to be the right thing because of the idea that the state can look after Hinduism better than the Hindu people can do it themselves. And the third point is that modernity should be defined in terms of updated tradition. Modernity is not something new, fangled, imported, taken either from Europe, America, Russia, or China. But modernity is something which is to be created by updating my own tradition in India. I'm talking about something in direct contrast to Nehru's ideas. Update your tradition and become modern. Don't reject your tradition and ape somebody outside India and be modern. And the fourth point, India does not need a secular state. India needs a dharmic state. Dharmic state does not mean a Hindu state or a state which is defined according to certain values or certain notions, metaphysical, religious, philosophic, of the so-called Hindu tradition. A dharmic state is that which looks after the welfare of the people without discriminating and which does not enforce theological prejudices on them and which does not divide its people according to their religious belief or according to various other parameters. And it is a state which is inclusive in every way, including the philosophic values. Now, this is something very important. It is something very different. What I am saying is something very different from Ishwar Allah Tero Naam, or that all religions are same, or that all religions are equal. No, I am talking of inequality in which nobody can preach inequality. So nobody can come around and tell me that I will go to hell because I don't follow a true religion, which is her religion or his religion. And nobody in a dharmic state can be allowed to define others in terms of non-believers or kafirs or heathens. Nobody can be given that right. Nobody can be given the right to define the future of others or the identity of others according to his religious notions or metaphysical notions. So a dharmic state is one which treats not only all human beings, it treats all human beings equally, but it also treats all living creatures equal, in which you regard the jivas, all the pranis, all the prajas, as having a right to exist and a right to life. So it is not the right to life of a minority or of a special category, but the right to life of any living creature, from an insect to an elephant. This is what a dharmic state is, where the fundamental principle is that no pain is to be caused to others, that any kind of pain which is caused to others should be avoided. The purpose of the dharmic state should be that the state gives freedom to people to pursue their own religious system. You see, it is a very wrong notion about ancient India that in ancient India the king was enforcing a particular religion. even if king was somebody like Ashoka who had adopted Buddhism, he never castigates the Vaishnavas or the Shaivas or people of other sampradayas. You do not find that kind of a... Or you can take the example of any other emperor, a Chalukya emperor or a Chola emperor or a Kashmiri emperor. The king was supposed to honor and did honor all different sects or sampradayas or denominations. So in that way, India has always been a dharmic state. And it is that system alone, the non-proselytizing state, which can be a dharmic state. There can be individuals who can preach. There is a difference between preaching and proselytizing. A fundamental distinction has to be made. Somebody who believes that others are going to hell and therefore I must save them is a proselytizer. Somebody who believes that others are in an error and I must set their minds right is a proselytizer. But somebody who says that, look, there is this way of looking at the world also, that there is this perception about this particular aspect of life or conduct or aim, and would you like to understand this? And this is what it is. And this is what I consider is the truth. Please listen to me. Let's have a dialogue. That is a dharmic state. And that is the Indian tradition. So, the last thing that I would like to say is that the country cannot be divided into minority and majority. Because it is an absurd notion. Right now, we think that anybody, any denomination, which even to the extent of being 49% can be a minority, is a ridiculous way of thinking. So we have to catch the bull by horns. We have to take care of all these perversions that we inherit from Nehru's Fabian state and go ahead to make a new India. Thank you very much for giving me a patient listening.
You have touched upon all the points that we who are nationalists and we who believe strongly in preserving and protecting the Indic faiths and our Sanatan Dharma and civilization that we talk about. You have touched on all those touch points. I just have actually two questions. One is more out of a curious, it's a curious question. I'm not from Delhi, but you have been a professor in Delhi University in history. Were you able to talk about any of these things while you were teaching your students? Were you able to have a discussion on those points? What was the reaction? Was there an openness to things? This is just out of my own curiosity, like I said, because I'm not from Delhi.
You know, I went to college in Delhi, St. Stephen's College, supposedly a very elite college from which many people who have ruined India come. I'm not one of them, but there are plenty who have done that. This was 64 to 69. I had a history teacher, a very fine Muslim young, well, at that time, young Muhammad Amin, and a very humorous chap. And he was teaching history, which was largely, you know, the Aligarh school history. Now, as a student, I was very uncomfortable when he told me that Muhammad Ghazni was in need of money, so he came and broke Somnath. And I do remember telling him that that is not an honest reason. Then I did question him about the Aryan invasion theory, just question because I was at that, you know, 17-year-old who had read the Vedas partly in Sanskrit and partly in Hindi, even at that age. I questioned him if there was any other argument except what was given at that time, you know, in 64. The argument was about the painted grey ware. you know, they said that, look, there is a painted gray ware pottery which shows a whole trail of the Aryan invasion, and you know the usual things which were said at that time. Now, my own knowledge of history at that time was not good enough to question them. I read history, particularly medieval history, when my guru Acharya Brihaspati asked me to read 10 volumes published from Aligarh, which were a translation of medieval history right from Taqqat-e-Nasiri, you know, earliest 8th, 9th century AD, to the period of Aurangzeb. This was a volume, 10 volumes published in Hindi by Attar Abbas Rizvi, something like Eliot and Dawson. Now, he made me read all these 10 volumes, and when I read that, then I understood what these people were teaching. And when I started teaching myself from 1972 onwards, and when R.S. Sharma, and you know, the gentleman who just passed away, Vijayendra Nath Jha, they were appointed, and they started, you know, gathering all kinds of Marxists around them, rewarding them. I've seen that whole thing, you see. So I opposed them. But then history was not my main thrust. I was cultivating Sanskrit literature, classical music, yoga, and various other things, reading the texts at that time. But I knew that these people were talking without a proper understanding, or let alone a proper understanding, a prejudice, an entire prejudice. It was ideology.
Yes, so the second, actually my question was about while you were teaching. So you said that you didn't teach history so much. So, but even while you were teaching the subjects you were teaching, were you able to engage with students on these very topics that you took up? That was actually what I intended. And also second one is, we are in a scenario right now, like you said, sir, where it's the same sort of thinking, whether it's a bureaucracy. So what do we do to remedy? What do we do?
I'll come to that later. Let me talk about, you know, this, my teaching. You see, I taught at Delhi University for 40 years, from 72 to almost end of 2011, right? For nearly 39 plus. First 20 years of mine was spent in study. So I studied classical music. I became a student, a professional music player under Pandit Umashankar Mishra. I studied musicology. I studied the text. And even in my college days, while I was doing English literature, I had a great teacher who was a professor of Sanskrit and who taught me the whole course of Sanskrit MA from first year to. So I was consolidating my knowledge of the primary texts and the tradition, first-hand knowledge. So I spent 20 years doing that. And then I started studying Greek, modern and classical, because I wanted to go right to the depth of Western civilization. As they always claim that we are the inheritors of Greeks and Romans, so I said, okay. And it was a study of Greek, and I did 15 years of study in classical Indian theater, comparing it with classical Greek theater, and wrote a book which was published in 94. Now, I always questioned the Nehruvian narrative after 10 years of my teaching. And then I became an oddball. Promotions were not denied to me, but so many opportunities were denied all the time. They never allowed me to become the chair of the English department, although I was very competent, much more than any of them. And they ridiculed my pursuit of Greek. Do you know the English department of Delhi University refused to register me for a PhD? And it was some Sanskrit scholar who registered me in Baroda, a Sanskrit and English literature scholar called V.Y. Kanta. So I lived fighting all my 40 years in Delhi University against this establishment. And I have no regrets, because I was able to do, fortunately, by the grace of my gurus, whatever I wanted, travel wherever I wanted, go and lecture wherever I wanted. So I was able to do it, but then I was always discouraged. I was always accosted. And apart from my salary, I was never given a single paisa for any research or for any kind of publication. But I am happy because I was able to do it. Now, in the last part of your question about the present state, you see, the present state is something that derives from the Nehruvian. In many respects, Atal Bihari Vajpayee was following Jawaharlal Nehru. And in many respects, our Modi ji, a great leader he is, and I proposed in 2012 that he be the next prime minister and gave a speech in his favor, which is recorded and reported in the press. But I find the same syndrome of not going back to the original texts of India, valuing them, and deriving your fresh values from them. I find the same syndrome. It's unfortunate. In 5 years that I have been trustee and executive member at IGNCA, I have tried to correct that course, whatever is possible. But then, you know, I'm a wayside scholar. I don't hold any position. I'm not an advisor to the government of India. That's a very piteous situation, especially for the Hindus, because the value of Bharatiya Vidyas can only be realized when you start practicing them, when you become familiar with them. If you say that Bharat Vishwa Guru Banega, India is going to be the guru of the world, or if you rely on such kind of slogans, I don't think much can be achieved. I hope that there is a course correction soon.
Dr. Gupt, you delivered an excellent exposition to tell how socialism destroyed our culture. Now, yes. I'm not debating for how many years we can blame Nehru for our ills, particularly after 2015. I also take cue from your reference to Israel, whose residents place nation first, and your reference about the state failure to promote enterprise, which may not be true after 1991 reform. Now, before posing my question, I wish to draw your attention to a talk given here by Mr. Girdhar sometime in December 2020. On unveiling the dragon that is China, which showed our use of imported goods, services, and investment from China despite being against our country's interest and our national humiliation in their hands. Now, sir, my question that follows is to know your views, how to inculcate in us pride in India. And the real question is, does not all our economic problems arise because we give first preference to individual profit in contrast to the profit of the community or the country at large. Thank you.
Okay. Now, look, I am not going to answer anything regarding economics or, talk about the present day government. I think on the economic front, there is a very good satisfactory record of supplying water and gas and this and that and all that Vikas thing. But as a stickler for some classical values, if you have to look on dharma, artha, kama and moksha, let us say artha and kama, then how can the two be balanced unless you understand what is culture? And where is the culture of India except in the vidyas of India? I would not even call it the knowledge systems of India. I would say all those arts and sciences which India has inculcated for thousands of years. Unless you are going to start practicing them, unless you are going to revive them practically, you are not going to have a cultural revolution. You are not going to have a cultural renaissance. Why did the 19th century have a flash in the pan kind of a renaissance? Because the study of the text was abandoned by the time of 1920s. It's something which coincides with the rise of Mahatma Gandhi. Because Gandhi was somebody who was in practice anti-classical. For him, there was no value of classical texts. And he had his own interpretation of Bhagavad Gita, which is an absolutely mistaken understanding of Bhagavad Gita. Now, this is exactly the problem. By 1920s, we abandoned our vidyas. Of course, there were some scholars, great scholars, like the man who did Dharma Shastras, etc., P.V. Kane, who continued the work, and there were many people right up to recent times like Kapila Vatsyayan. But leave aside individual, the nation as a whole should have in 1950 started on a new journey. It should have started on a new journey in 2000 when the BJP government came into power. But it did not, and it does not, because you still do not put that in the forefront. You are still thinking of Vikas. You are still thinking of Vishwas. Now, Vikas is good. But if your Vishwas is misplaced, if you do not understand the basis of Vishwas and the values of Vishwas, then somebody else is going to enjoy your Vikas. You can do whatever amount of Vikas you like, but then somebody else will come to enjoy it. Or somebody else from within the nation would become dominant. So this is the cultural discourse which we have to understand. And this job has to be done very mercilessly.
It so happens that I quite agree with everything that Professor Gupta says. So, you see, of course, everybody knows that the problem of India is Jawaharlal Nehru, to sum it up in one word. This socialism that he foisted on India has been in focus because of the secularist element, but the economic element has been equally detrimental in the sense that the artificial poverty of India has caused or has aggravated many of the cultural problems. You see, India would have been far better able to find back itself if it hadn't been pushed permanently into this poverty. So let me take the opportunity to praise somebody who is much regretted, or in his absence, namely Arun Shauri, who was the Minister for Privatization under Vajpayee and was greatly instrumental in the fabulous growth figures that India finally obtained then. So nothing particular was done by him except to allow the creativity and the dynamism of the Indian people to flourish. You see, it was not the government that made India rich, it's the people of India who did. And so that trust in the Indian people, that's what Nehru took away, and that's what wiser governments have to bring back. That's mainly what I thought, you see, in your excellent discourse.
Yeah, I agree very much with what you point out. And in fact, one of the biggest drawbacks of the present government has been that it is still it's still not pursuing the course of liberalization. It's still scared. You know, that fear of handing over businesses to the people. Now, I am not saying it to Adani and Ambani and just three or four, you know, who are quoted all the times by Rahul Gandhi, but I am saying about people as a whole. As I said, that look, it is the working, enterprising people of India at the lowest level who have to be liberated to pursue their own skills. You see, this is how India has always generated its wealth. It's not the Kshatriyas who were generated wealth. They were patronizing and very often wasting it. But it is the working class and the business community who were generating wealth. And if you study Kautilya, you will find that Kautilya has a very tolerant, liberal, sympathetic attitude to the working classes. By working classes, I always mean those who work with their hands and produced, because he imposed none or very little taxation on them. There was heavy taxation on the Vaishyas or the mercantile class. They were the biggest contributors, and they were also the biggest contribution was made by them for welfare, more than the kings. The welfare was done by the people, and it was the Vaishyas and the community, which was an entirely different model from the Western capitalist model. The Western capitalist model, they have agendas which are very personal, like Bill Gates has an agenda, or some other rich people. They always have either a political agenda or an agenda to transform the economy according to their notion. Whereas the Vaishyas of India were providing wealth to certain very simple set norms, like building roads, building lakes, like building things which were today what we call bijli pani sadak, which were used by everybody. But Nehru socialism deprived India of this class totally. And to this day, it is an abuse class. Rahul Gandhi has no compunctions in abusing them, whether for political reasons or for personal reasons, because he is not receiving so much contributions from them.
My question is, you had mentioned just now that India seems to have abandoned classicism. Now, from my perhaps very naive outlook, for example, if I want to listen to, say, Indian classical music, it's easily obtainable and I don't have to look for artists that sang in the 50s. You know, you have young people who still sing, who still perform. Similarly, I would imagine that in the metros, at least, you have regular performances of classical dance and things like that. So if this is not good enough, what, according to you, is in India that has not abandoned classicism?
Yeah. You see, first of all, by classical, one should not think of classicism in the same manner as Europe used to. You see, in Europe, the idea of classic art means art for the elite. It is for the upper classes. Whereas in India, that's not the case. I mean, very poor people listen to so-called raga music or classical music. They practice it, they sing it. When I was learning sitar from Pandit Umar Shankar Mishra, one of the fellow students was a DTC bus driver, and he was learning better than me. So, answer to your question is this, that today the arts are present in certain metro cities under the patronage of the official class, under the patronage of this Asharaf and Afsar, you know, the elite and the bureaucrat. They are not patronized by people. In my childhood, which is in 50s, there were music concerts in small towns like Meerut, which was 1/10 of what it is today, or in Moradabad, or in Bareilly, or Shahjahanpur, not only Lucknow and Banaras, but these small, little small towns. Artists would go there and give all-night concerts. In my home in Moradabad, the great doyen of Gwalior Gharana, Krishnav Shankar Pandit, came and sang from 8 in the evening till 6 in the morning. And he sang to about 55 or 60 local people who belong to that very small town. Now, this kind of contact with the art has disappeared. Why? Because instead of promoting the artist at the regional level, at the district level or mufassil level, they wanted to promote the artists in the institutions of Delhi, not in the university. You see, art is not part of any university curriculum in the country even today. I mean, there may be some small exception and some small courses, but art, theater, poetry, all this is not part of the full teaching curriculum of any Indian university. And BJP is kind of, what shall I say, playing the ball with the new education policy for last 7 years. I mean, it's something which can be done in 1 week. You can make a new education policy in 1 week. You just have to sit, bring 5 enlightened people, and they can dictate a policy to a small clerk of Shastri Bhavan, and you can implement it from next day. You don't have to make this whole pretense of inviting millions of people to give suggestions and then to, you know, sieve their connections and then still not do anything. Why is this happening? Because you don't know what you will teach. You don't know what you will teach because you have not even seen those texts, let alone study those texts. There are millions of manuscripts lying in Indian libraries and manuscript libraries. Not even 500 have been published since the BJP came to power. Was it so difficult to publish 500 manuscripts from Tanjore Library or Srinagar Library and ask the scholars which are the ones which should be done to be translated into various Indian languages? Now, that's because you don't think that it is worth doing anything.
I have this very simple question. When we talk about majority and minority, and we look at the just a ray of hope, you know, what has happened in Assam, wherein the chief minister has said that, you know, the government funding will not go to the madrasas, at least the government-run madrasas. And when we look at something like this, we can see that it has happened because of all the conversation which is happening around the country. You know, wherein people are raising question on why minority, why are you suppressing majority in the name of that? How do you look at it? And do you think that could be a start?
Well, I said very clearly, unambiguously, that you have to reframe Article 28, 29, 30. Let anybody have the right to establish an institution and teach, no matter they are majority, minority, regional, very regional. It should have no relationship with numerical strength in the total country. And hence all this dole which is given on the basis of minority, all this reservation and all these special things like make a Urdu university or even a Sanskrit university, it should go. Let people do it. You just have to watch it to see that anti-national things or things against public interest are not taught. But as long as people are not preaching secession or they are not preaching violence against others, you should allow them to run their own courses, to have their own universities, to give their own degrees. I see no harm in it. That will help the countries and that will solve this whole problem of making a minority which would claim rights which are against the majorities and make it eventually into a Hindu-Muslim conflict. Regarding madrasas, I have one very serious question. When is the education ministry going to analyze the curriculum of the madrasas? I don't want to say much more on this, but it has to be put to a fine comb, because quite a few things which are taught there are perhaps not inclusive. They create a distinction between the believer and the kafir. And from that, you start a whole kind of a distinction which has to be questioned now.
Sir, recently a general in Pakistan said that a child who has studied in madrasa all his life, wo yaar wo maulvi ban sakta hai ya jihadi ban sakta hai bas.
Yeah, this was said by a very Pakistani scholar called Ghamidi. I can send anybody who wants me a full video, about 5-7 minutes video on this. He's a great scholar, Ghamidi, who said this. And because what madrasas are teaching is something which was formulated in the time of soon after Aurangzeb, in the time reign of Aurangzeb and a little later. And we know that that Aurangzeb was, all said and done, nothing less than a jihadi.
We have seen many science students coming in arts now. So is it good?
As long as you are able to study your non-science, your humanities subject well, as long as you are able to pursue it in a logical manner, it's something to be welcome. If you come from a science background, then you bring a understanding of analyzing things, which is what is needed in humanities today. Certainly. You see, anvikshiki was the first quality required of an Indian intellectual. Anvikshiki means able to analyze. analysis. You know what is analysis means opening knots. In Greek, it means opening. Analysis means opening the knots, the leases.
Rather, the upliftment and the welfareism considered as a socialism part, and many people debate that it's not the socialism part. So can you elaborate something on it?
Look, socialism is an economic model for the state. It means no or very little private property. It means if there is no private property, if everything is owned by the state fully or partially, then the state has to provide everything to the people. Now, that model has been abandoned everywhere in the world. It has not worked. It has been abandoned in China also. China is not a socialist state. It is a highly capitalist state with a communist party in power. It's a totalitarian state.
Has the Nehruvian policies, is it responsible for the destruction of any kind of idea of a civilizational empire? For example, we see China, it sees itself as the Middle Kingdom. That guy in Turkey, Erdogan, they see themselves as the successor for Ottoman Empire. Even the Iranians see themselves as the successor of Persian Empire. The British have a grand narrative of the empire. Even the Japanese do have it. And the Indian state itself is like a rudderless ship in the sea, where we don't know what is the future that we are holding because we don't know what we want. So,
yeah, well, look, very apt question, because you say that Erdogan wants to be the Mustafa and China wants to be the Middle Kingdom. They have a model. So do we have a model? Now, we have several models. Rajarajeshwar Chola, right?
Yes.
The queen of the Karkota Empire, Chandragupta Maurya, Samudragupta. You know, there are several models, but fortunately for us, the idea of the state has been encapsulated very well after combining several other texts into Kautilya's Arthashastra. And there is, right in the very first line, the whole book has been encapsulated. Anvikshaki Trayi Varta, Anvikshaki Trayi Varta, Dandanitishcha Iti Vidya. So there are four things that a state rests upon. Analysis, seeing different philosophies, different systems, different political systems of the enemy, of the friend, Anvikshaki. Trayi, the Vedas, the Vedic values. Varta means business, commerce. And Dandaniti, that is law. Law which has the ability to punish the crime, criminal. Now, these are the four things. And then you have a huge book which elaborates on these four things. So the state has to be this. The state need not be a historical model. Why should we follow a historical model? Why should we try to go back into history and emulate the life at a given time and a given period? Why not take principles? Now, these are four principles. Let's see how we can practice them, how we can add something else to them. How can we, you need Anvikshaki today. You don't understand today what is a communist state. You don't understand today what is a American democratic state or wokeism. You don't understand any of these philosophies. You don't understand what's happening to Islam. How Islam is transforming or not transforming, or Christianity. We don't do any of that Anvikshaki. And Trayi means the Vedic tradition, not just the Vedas, but the whole text of India. So are you going to study the text of India or not? Varta is business, commerce. And commerce changes according to times and technology. And Dandaniti will be, punishing would be, according to the values you have formulated on the basis of Anvikshiki, Veda, and Varta, or commerce, your interest, economic interest. So if we don't have, I mean, we have several kingdoms to emulate, but then why should we emulate any one of them? Why not emulate a Shastra which lays down the principles of governance, Artha? Artha Shastra means statecraft.
So very well that Nehru did so much of cultural damage, but how does the fact that Nehru could do so much cultural damage and still he enjoyed so much political popularity reflect upon the broader Hindu society? I mean, don't we share the blame as well? I mean, ultimately, it's our society. It's a reflection of who we are and what do we do about it? And what are we doing about it even now?
That's a wonderful question. And I should have actually addressed it in my talk. Thank you for pointing out something that I just didn't think of. Now, let me very briefly say, Nehru had this popularity. Of course, a very quick answer would be because Gandhi installed him. And so people had to suffer him no matter what he did. But the reason why somebody who belonged to another milieu, who belonged to your to the thought processes of your erstwhile rulers, why he continued to be popular was because in the 19th century, the Indian intellectual class became so intimidated by Christianity that they thought of everything beautiful, everything to be reformed, everything to be attained in terms of the Christian values. You see, some of our great leaders like Swami Dayanand Saraswati, now, while he was a great man who promoted the education of women and remarriage of widows and many other things, and he was a great savant of education, but he thought that Vedas had no devatas. So he thought of Vedas as non-polytheistic, as talking about one Parampita Parmeshwar. That's the translation he makes for Indra, Varuna, Mitra, etc. in his translation of Vedas. Now, where does this Parampita Parmeshwar come from? He comes from Christianity.
Our Father in Heaven.
Our Father in Heaven. So Pateras or Father, right? Patros. Patros, Eos, and Agios Pneuma, the Holy Ghost, the Christian Trinity. And even Vedanta became a Holy Trinity for Bengal reformists. You see, all those people who believed in Abhinindranath and Debendranath and that whole movement of Brahmo Samaj, for them, Brahmo was the Holy Ghost. So we were really defining our values according to Christianity. And similarly, Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi looked upon ahimsa, not in Indian terms. By Indian, I mean as in Mahabharata or even in Ramayana. But he had his own version of absolute ahimsa. I mean, he thought he was a Buddha who would just raise his hand and an Angulimal would come and fall at his feet. He tried it, but he had to give Pakistan to Jinnah. He could not influence him. So this was the syndrome which was transferred to us. This ahimsa. And then, this whole concept of brahmacharya that Mahatma Gandhi had. Now, that was again a Christian concept of brahmacharya. There is no such brahmacharya in Hindu thought. Brahmacharya is according to your ashram. Your ashram. Grihastha ashram has one kind of brahmacharya. Gandhi started a sannyasi's brahmacharya in Grihastha ashram. Now, how did these errors happen, this miscalculation happen? Because you were not familiar with your own texts. This whole prejudice against worship of form, worship in temple. You see, when I went to college, I was taught that worshipping in a temple is a lower form of worship. And doing yoga or dhyan is a higher form of worship. So Tulsidas is somebody who misled the Hindu society. And Kabir is the one who delivered it. But when I read Kabir again, and when I read the Yoga Sutras themselves, and from a yogi and an adept and a master, then I realized there's all this talk of Nirguna Brahma is impossible to make any sense of unless you have worshipped Saguna Brahma, unless you have worshipped a god in form. And that is the symbiosis in which all Indian philosophies have worked. That's why they made statues of Buddha. That's why they made statues of Mahavir. That's why Shankaracharya wrote the great Saundarya Lehri in worship of Devi. So it is a knowledge of your first-hand knowledge, an intimate knowledge of your own text, which enlivens your tradition and reveals your tradition. That's why, because that thing could not, that whole enterprise could not carry on because of all these Christian prejudices. And it is to this day. It is to this day that modern proselytizers in the shape of Indologists are influencing us. You see, most of the Indologists are still not free from Christian bias. That's my answer. That's part of the reason. I mean, I'll ask you a very unpleasant question. Has the present government of BJP been able to escape an overestimation of Mahatma Gandhi? I'm putting my observation very clinically.
And I would, for your question, I would say no. Because they cannot. Because they cannot. There are way too many liberals in this country. Three generations of what you call secular or liberal.
Gandhi was not liberal. He was liberal to Jinnah only.
Those who worship him are liberals.
Gandhi was not liberal to Sardar Patel. Gandhi was not liberal to our Subhash Chandra Bose. Gandhi was liberal to the Ali brothers in 1920s. He was liberal to Jawaharlal Nehru or Mountbatten, but he was not liberal to Bhagat Singh or Chandrasekhar Azad. Because if you believe in pluralism, then you let others do what they want also, which was not the case.
And there is a remark from a participant, Deepanjali. She says, "Please inform, sir, that I agree that Gandhi is on the same pedestal today as before, and to have such an unquestioned respect for someone is not good for any country."
Well, I will not talk in terms of respect or disrespect. I will talk in terms of simply analyzing the philosophy of Gandhi. Does it fall in with the Hindu tradition? Or does it not? Gandhi, Satya, Ahimsa, and Brahmacharya do not follow the traditional Hindu interpretation of Satya, Ahimsa, and Brahmacharya. So Gandhi was not being innovative. Gandhi was being disruptive.
I will outrightly agree that I am compulsively opinionated about both Gandhi and Nehru. I have my reasons, I have my studies too, for where we are now. And this is part of the question, because now, even though we are infested in the universities, in the bureaucracy, and even in the judiciary by Marxists. So they wanted to maintain the status quo. The current dispensation has the problem of good boy syndrome. They don't want to change. So what is the tangible change we can expect, or what is the logical solution for this?
Well, you know, I'll refrain from making any comment on BJP or RSS or assessing them. That's not what is part of my study at all. But I have said in principle that the way forward is something which has to be radically different from what we are doing now. And I gave you some 4 or 5 points in my lecture. So unless we progress along those lines, we don't see any likely change. I mean, water may come to all villages and all homes, and we will hopefully very soon come out of the corona problem. Along with the leadership of Sri Narendra Modi, and he's quite capable of doing all that. But the great task remains of giving a different cultural orientation. And that anybody who wants to secure the future of India has to do.
I have a question which would be more politically inclined. So if we observe the time frame between 1947 and till 1977, there were around 5 educational ministers who were all Muslims, including Fakhruddin Ali Ahmed and Humayun Kabir, etc. And we had also observed that the madrasas were emerging, and then simultaneously Hindu gurukuls were vanishing. So do you think it to be one of these strategies which were being employed by the Congress government to play the narrative which they were intending to be played down the street?
Well, obviously, I mean, this started as soon as the constitution was announced. I said it to you very clearly that Article 28, 29 and 30 are anti-Hindu. So this started in 1950. You know, they make Hindus unequal. And there is no reason for that, because we should ask for an equal status for everybody. Let Muslims teach Islam, certainly, as much as they want. Of course, they should not teach jihad, but let them teach Islam. And let them teach in madrasas. And let Hindus have their schools and teach as freely as the madrasas are teaching, but under state supervision, so that nothing inimical to the Indian state is taught.
My question is regarding the right to private property, which was a fundamental right in the beginning when the constitution was framed. But later on, it was shifted under the 24th Amendment in 1971 under Indira Gandhi government into a constitutional or a legal right, where it will not be a fundamental right, but it will be governed by the law. So now my question here is that the judiciary was constantly shifting goalposts. And they always looked at what government is in power to give their decision of basic structure, and then it is not basic structure, and all those kind of judgments that they gave. And surprisingly, they took out this fundamental right and said it didn't harm the basic structure any which ways. So this constitution is something beyond my understanding. But my question is that I think, as you mentioned, that this is one way of dehumanizing Hindus, because after all the loot that happened during the British time, the only thing Hindus had was property. And they used to use it for probably gurukuls and helping the Hindu temples and everything. So yes, I personally think it was a strategy of the Congress government and also the Britishers to further emaciate the Hindus. And because we also know the Waqf boards, how it works, that if there is a place where there is a Islamic religious congregation going on for a long time, it can become a Waqf property. But that doesn't apply to gurukuls or any other institutions. So this is my question, that should the fundamental right to property, because we see state governments occupying properties like the Shanti Sthal and all these, and occupying huge spaces. So isn't that an abuse of property? And then you say private, because I know a private citizen always has a judicious mind when he goes to buy property, but the state does not earn it and he completely splurges it. So my question to you is, I've always had this ping pong understanding that what exactly do we need? Do we need this right to property being taken away, or should it be given back? Because that is always a subject of debate.
Very frankly, I'll have to study the subject in detail. But offhand, I can say one thing, that when you get rid of these fuzzy notions of socialism, which have harmed us for so long under Nehru's Fabianism, then the state would not have an obligation to acquire and run so many responsibilities, and therefore it would not need so much land as state land. See, the state has to have the power to take property from somebody in national interest, not in the interest of a party or state. Of course, national interest also can be abused. But at the same time, an individual should not be pressurized to give things, because it is the whim or a policy that a state has just, without thinking, formulated. See, the solution comes when we become more aware of the right of the individual, but that right of the individual should also be ensured to be functioning in public interest, not just giving up to the state. You see, today we think of the individual as somebody who is just going to be, say, selfish individual. So if you think of the individual or individual corporation or places as those which run things in public benefit, then our attitude would change.
Regarding the question asked by Tanaya ji, that the constitution allows the government interference into religious matters because of the act, Hindu Religious Endowment and Charitable Act of 1951. Basically, it gives the government absolute right over what to do with the management of temples and of the property that are owned by the temples. And as far as the constitution is concerned, that is a whole another can of worm, because it will take a separate session by an equally studious jurisdiction or some kind of judicial application of mind for that. And my question to Mr. Bharat is that how is it that the historical changes, or I read an article which said that history is kind to Nehru because he was the one who wrote it. How are they able to get away with it?
No, I think in this of matter, Nehru is not to be blamed so much, because he took no interest in temples whatsoever. It is really the British who had laid the foundation of the temple takeover. Now the Supreme Court has already ruled that the state cannot run the temples endlessly and perpetually. It can only take over the administration for a while till such time certain malpractices are redressed. So, we are waiting for the Modi government to take the next step, which is to abolish these different Dev Swam boards and different state boards, bring in a, at least I am waiting, bring in a central law and free the temples and give them to the sampradayas and the bhaktas of individual temples. The constitution not only allows it, it ensures it. And that point is settled now. Very well settled.
I'm not sure if you had answered my question. See, yeah. Even I am happy about the current dispensation because we can't get better than this. I'm sure about it. But only thing is, see, this Marxist group and liberal group are there. They are wielding with more power in terms of media and everything. So, and they wanted the status quo to be maintained. And how do we handle them, or how do we overcome them? That's a big challenge.
See, right now it is not just the Marxist within India. Right now, India is challenged by a large number of international global forces, Christian proselytizers, Islamic jihadis, and of course the left, liberal left, you know, which is right now in power in the United States also. Hinduism has to confront all of them. And for confronting that, you have to change certain laws within the country. Changing those laws does not mean that you deny equal rights to Muslims or Christians or any other denomination within India. But it only means to bring an end to the politics of endless concessions and thereby endless inequality. And that can be done. There is still time for it, because Hindus are in majority and they have to be convinced that they should wake up and create a society in which Muslims, Christians, Parsis can live as equal citizens, but not as people asking for special concessions all the time. See, right now we think that special concessions are the birthright of minorities. And the Congress government has created this perversion. That's why Manmohan Singh said that minorities have the first right to national resources. How more pervert can you get?
Bharatji, I think you have already answered a fraction of it. Yeah. So adding to the question someone has asked, that why the society has not been able to shun Nehru ideology. And recently, in 2019, I think there was a Earth talk where a gentleman who professed that he's an ex-Nehruvian said that, you know, when you talk about people who believe in Nehruvian ideology, you have to understand where they come from. They actually believe that India as a, you know, did not exist before independence. And of course, the genius mind behind that was Gandhi, Nehru, and Patelji was the arm of it. And he says that when you talk to these people and when you try and talk about things that existed before independence, it threatens their identity of India that they understand. So if you have to talk to them, you have to hit, you know, you have to, rather than ridiculing them, you have to ask them questions, as you correctly said, ask questions and challenge their ideology. Because these people have firm belief that before independence, there was nothing called Hindu Dharma. Hindu Dharma was a modern construct that was supposed to oppose anything which the elites were bringing to the society. And the same way scriptures were just a tool for it. Dharma was a tool for it. So,
see, if you go to the internet and go to my YouTube channel, then you will see a lecture there which I gave in response to a Singaporean journalist. Why are foreigners afraid of Hindutva? Now, I have shown there that Hindutva is a straw man which these people have constructed. You see, today, people like the ones you mentioned just now, they always abuse Hinduism, belittle it, and then they say, no, no, we are not belittling Hinduism, we are belittling Hindutva. Now, in that video, I have said that Hindutva is Hinduism that talks back. Hinduism that asks questions from Christians, Muslims, and others. And that is what they don't like. Now, before you can talk Hinduism and talk back from Hinduism, you have to study Hinduism. And that is my grouse against all the governments, including the present government, that they have not created that environment of study. Unless you do that, you do not recreate your civilization. How did the modern Europeans recreate their civilization in 16th century, 15th, 16th century? How did they create a Renaissance? By studying the texts of Greeks and Romans. Because they didn't have their own texts, other than some Christian texts and Bible. We have hundreds of texts, thousands of texts. And once you apply your mind, a whole regeneration, a whole renaissance will happen.